Good evening, everybody. Hopefully I'm not too loud, though. All right. My name is Dan Dino. I'm the chair of SB 31. I shouldn't really be talking because I've done the least amount of work of all four of these people. Well, I keep saying it's true. We're really happy to have everybody here. This is a fantastic time. I'm just going to say just one couple of words and let everybody else introduce themselves. We're really, really proud to have these four people on stage for us tonight. We're really proud to have our good friend Sue Jeffers and Walter Hudson run this program for us. Without further ado, I'll let Nancy Manson introduce herself.
Yeah. Thanks, Dan. Just good. Hi, I'm chair of Senate District 35. That's Randy Anilka from Rapids and Andover.
Thanks for coming, everybody. My name is Rod Garbus. I'm chair of SB 36, which is Coon Rapids, Champlain, Brooklyn, Barth Valley. We had a fun time putting this event on. Thanks to all of you for coming. Thanks to Sue Jeffers and Walter, and thanks especially to the candidates for running. Get Mark Dayton out of St. Paul.
Yeah. And I'm Dave Morrell. I'm the chair of the Senate District 37 Republicans, which is Lane, Coon Rapids, portion of Coon Rapids. I think Coon Rapids is split between three of our SDs and Springlake Park. So again, thank you. I won't keep you any longer. And we're going to get Sue up here and get this thing started. Have a good night.
Thank you so much for coming out, because this is one of the most important elections that we have coming up. We've seen what's happened this last session. One party rule doesn't work very well. And not only do we need to win the governor's race, but we need to win every race from the governor's race on down. That's how important this is. This is more important than the battle for the soul of the Republican Party, which you know we are having a battle for the soul of the Republican Party. This is also a battle for the soul of the state of Minnesota. Do you want to give Governor Dayton a ranking for how he's done as governor of Minnesota? Yes, he deserves an F. You know where he was on Wednesday? Another secret trip. You know where the secret trip was? San Francisco. San Francisco. Well, of course businesses want to leave San Francisco. And what, they want to come to Minnesota who's following the same path of San Francisco? Are you kidding me? This battle is a big one. We have to work really, really hard to reduce the size, scope, and expense of government. What we're going to do tonight is we're going to basically start interviewing candidates who would like to be our next governor. And we're not going to settle. We are going to demand bold leadership. We are going to demand bold leadership. No more of this go along to get along. No more of this I'm afraid of the media. No more of this I'm a Democrat light. We've had enough. We're going to hell in a handbasket, and this is the election that can turn every single thing around. I want to talk about the marriage amendment for just a moment, because the marriage amendment was a perfect microcosm of what's happening within the Republican Party. After the amendment was passed, but when the Republicans were in control, the Democrats got mad. And what did the Republicans do? Nothing. Nothing. And what did most of the religious organizations do? Nothing. And they left us hanging out to dry. As a candidate who was out there door knocking this last legislative session, I saw it happen. But when somebody said something to me about the marriage amendment, not only did I defend it as a Republican, but I defended it as Sue Jeffers. You know why? Because I have a right to that belief. I have a right to my religious liberty, my religious freedom. I will not let them call me a bigot or a homophobe or a hater. And most importantly, I will not let them silence me. And the same thing should apply for you, and the same thing should be expected from our candidates. We don't run away from our battles because we can win. Do you know right now the general public trusts Republicans by 8% over the Democrats on jobs? And the general public trusts Republicans on the economy by 4%. We win. We win when we talk about light rail transit not being an effective form of transportation. We win when we talk about government spending. Think of all the things that government is doing now. It is big, it is expensive, and it is intrusive. It tells us what kind of cars we have to drive. It tells us what kind of food we have to eat. It tells us where we can smoke. It tells us what kind of insurance we have to buy. That isn't just happening at a national level, that's happening at our statewide level too. Our budget is phenomenal for a state of 5 million people. We must demand better. So right now we're gonna start interviewing these guys. We're not gonna let them get away with empty rhetoric. We wanna hear their plans and their ideas. Baby that he is, and he starts name calling, and the press lets him get away with it too. We're not gonna be like that. We're not gonna be, okay, I will on my radio show, we're not gonna be like that. We're gonna take the high road. But you know what? We're not gonna tolerate. We're gonna explain to them why we're Republicans and what we stand for, and we're gonna articulate those positions, and we're gonna defend those positions. So ultimately, of these, we're gonna see four tonight. I think we'll see a couple more candidates get in there, but I want you to do one more thing. Once we get our candidate, we're gonna do everything we can to help them win. And right now, I want you guys to promise me you're gonna be door knocking, you're gonna be writing checks, you're gonna be making phone calls, not just for the governor's race, for all the Republican races. And the second thing I want you to do is, we have got to have more election judges. More election judges, more absentee ballots. I'm gonna take 1 minute and explain to you about Little Canada, Precinct 1. Leaned Democrat, 17 points. Three fabulous candidates worked that district. Yeah, I was one. And I know I'm really good, but I'm not that good that I could move the needle 17 points, but I did. I won Little Canada, won. And you know what? We had a poll watcher, we had an election judge, and we work the district. We can win, people, we can win. Yay, let's go 2014.
Welcome to the Minnesota Governor Candidate Forum tonight. At this time, I'm going to invite our candidates to come up on stage and take a seat. And while they're doing that, I just want to take a moment. You guys can fight it out. I just want to take a moment to once again thank the organizers of this forum tonight. You heard from Dave Morrell, chair of 7th District 37, Jonathan Fisher, who's the vice chair of 31. The two of them, this was their brainchild. They received help from Rod Garberson, chair of SD 36, Nancy Benson, chair of 37, and Dan Dino, chair of 31. So once again, please give a round of applause. It's always great to see cooperation between our local Republican BPOUs, our local Republican groups, and I think it goes without saying, just by looking around the room, that this event has already been a great success. I also want to take a moment to recognize a lot of folks who are here in the room tonight, and unfortunately, there's probably too many to actually start calling out by name, but if you're an elected official currently, if you could just please stand, any elected officials we have in the room? We have a lot of fun throwing rocks at those people, but it takes a tremendous amount of commitment to take time away from your family and serve the public in the capacity that they do. I'd also like to take a moment to recognize any unannounced candidates for office. I know we have Randy Gilbert here, who's running for state auditor. Category, and this might get a little bit bigger. I want to recognize any party officers. If you're involved in your local BPOU as a party officer, the state party. I know we've got our secretary in the room. Did he step out? Thank you very much for your service. Awesome, thankless job. And finally, I want to take a moment. Now, anybody who in the last, let's say, 40 years has donated money or volunteered for a campaign, if you could please stand and be recognized. This coming election cycle in 2014. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Some people are apparently waiting to see what they hear tonight. That's understandable. All right, with that said, let me just quickly go over the rules and format for tonight. It's pretty basic.
Watch this camera.
We're going to start with opening candidate statements. They're each going to get 2 minutes to give you an introduction. About who they are and why it is that they are running to be our next governor here in the state of Minnesota and to move Mark Dayton somewhere else. And then we're going to go into our question and answer period. And we're going to ask a question and let each one of them have an opportunity to give a 1 minute response. So that's going to be 4 minutes per question. So the time's going to go by quicker than you might think. So without further ado for me, let's go ahead and start closest to me with Senator Dave Thompson, and you have 2 minutes, sir, to introduce yourself.
Thank you. It's great to be here this evening. I would be remiss if I didn't introduce my wife, Rhonda, and my daughter, Amanda. It's great to have your support and have them here. If you would acknowledge the program. Wedding anniversary on Saturday of being incurable romantic, but I am. I will go leave her at home, go to 2 county fairs, and eat plenty of cheese curds for the both of us. That's my plan. All right, when I was a little tyke, I grew up in Little Falls, Minnesota. My mother moved my sister and me to East Grand Forks after my parents divorced. My grandfather had the foresight to actually make sure that my mother had a college education, kind of uncommon for a woman who was raised in the 1940s. But fortunately, she had the ability to teach piano lessons and keep food on the table for my mother and me. I had a public education, went all the way through the school system in East Grand Forks, Minnesota, went to public college across the river at the University of North Dakota, and then went to the University of Minnesota. So I've kind of had the typical Minnesota experience. I've been a small business owner. I've also been an employee, so I've signed both paychecks as an employer and paychecks as an employee. I've had some successes. Had some struggles. So I guess what I'm telling you is I've had a career that has allowed me to prepare myself to be the chief executive of this state, and that's why I would ask for your support. I have had now 3 sessions in the Minnesota Senate. So while the vast majority of my experience has been in the private sector, I have lived with the state budget for the last 3 years. I understand how it works. But you not only need somebody who's qualified to be governor, you need somebody who has the ability to win. And I think many of you out there would agree because you've told me communication has been a major problem for us in this party. I have been a professional communicator for over a decade, and I believe that my ability to articulate what we believe in a way that Minnesotans accept it will allow me to be Mark Dayton, beat Mark Dayton and be your next governor. Thank you.
Mr. Scott Honor.
Thanks for having me. Let me start by introducing my wife, Jamie. Jamie, where are you? Oh, there she is, right there. So I'm a businessman. I'm not a politician. When I was born in Fridley, my parents lived in a trailer park. My father became an airline pilot, and we moved to Mound, where I grew up. I graduated from Mound West Tonka High School. It was great having a dad as a pilot, but when I was in high school, he lost his job. That created a real challenge for our family. But we persevered through that. During that same time, I became an Eagle Scout. I participated in sports in school, went to Boys State, was editor of my school paper, and I went on to pay my way through college, had a bunch of odd jobs, worked at Lord Fletcher's in the summers, shoveled horse manure out of the stables while I went to school. I'm sure I'm going to be able to make use of that skill in St. Paul. And after getting a graduate degree in business, I went on to pursue a career in business and created success for my family, created financial security. Ultimately, I led a firm that over the last decade has bought and fixed 60 companies around the country and around the world. I've also started a couple companies. I feel like I've lived the American dream. And I want that for my children, and I want that for everyone's children. And that's what's driven me to run for governor. Because I see our state going in exactly the wrong direction, and our current leadership has just put its foot on the accelerator. And I think it's time for a real reset of government. We need someone who will be transformational. And that's what I've done in business. I want to apply my skills and my leadership capabilities to take this state on a new direction. But I'm not looking for a permanent career change. I view myself as taking a sabbatical from business. I want to get in there, transform our state, and then turn it back over to a next generation of leaders, and look forward to getting to know all of you better. Thank you.
Hennepin County Commissioner Jeff Johnson.
Thank you all for being here. My wife is actually in Houston, so we've been bachelors at home, the two boys and I, so we've been having a lot of Pop-Tart dinners lately, so life is good at our house. Otherwise, she would be here. But I know a lot of you. Let me give you the real quick background on me. I grew up in northern Minnesota, as my wife did, Sandy. We went to Concordia up in Moorhead. We've been in Plymouth for about 18 years. We have two boys. Thor is 15, Rolf is 12. We've got a three-year-old bulldog named Chester that spends a lot of time with me on the campaign trail. I have spent more than half of my adult life in the private sector, both as an employee and as a self-employed small business person. During that time, I also served 6 years in the Minnesota House of Representatives, and now the last 4.5 years, I've been on the Hennepin County Board as the lone, somewhat loud voice of a tiny bit of fiscal sanity in the state's largest county. And I'm running for governor, and I'm seeking your endorsement. I want to ask something, though, of you tonight, because you're going to listen to us and you're going to hear us say a lot of the same things. You really have four, I believe, solid candidates, any one of whom would make a good governor. But that's what I want to ask of you. I don't want you to think tonight just like a Republican activist. And I know this might be a tall order, but I want you to try to think tonight like your independent, maybe even your DFL neighbors. Because to win this race, we're going to need a chunk of your independent neighbors and maybe even a handful of your DFL neighbors to actually win. And again, I know that's going to be easy, but not going to be easy, but that's going to be something that we have to get done. And I believe if we're able to do that, and you're able to ask the question, how will my neighbors relate to these guys? Which one of these guys is going to be trusted enough and liked enough by my neighbors that they'll actually be able to say no to all those tempting DFL promises and say yes to some of our Republican realities? If we can look at the race that way and choose a conservative who can actually be endorsed and elected, that's how we're going to win next year. I would appreciate your support. Thank you so much.
Former Speaker of the House, Kurt Zellers.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for the invitation. Thank you also for being here. My wife, Kim, being the very dutiful and very gracious wife, is actually filling in for me at an event tonight, so haha, guys. I appreciate not only the privilege, but the honor to be amongst some really great people, but three really great candidates. I agree with Jeff that at the end of the day, you're going to see three, and we'll be better. Trust me, this is the first one. By the time we get to the last one, we'll be much better at what we're doing. But I'm running for two reasons. Two very simple, but very near and dear to my heart reasons. Reagan Hope Zellers and William Charles Zellers. My two kids. And yes, I spelled Reagan the right way. Don't trust me, I'm an absolute dyed-in-the-wool Republican. But I want Reagan and Will to have their job, to have their career, to build their family here. A good friend of mine has a daughter and a son. He said to me, Kurt, here's why I want you to run for governor and what I want you to do as governor. My son's the best guy in banking in the world. works over in Switzerland. My daughter started her first startup over in Singapore. He says, my wish for you and for all Minnesotans isn't that they have Christmas and Thanksgiving on two separate continents. Build a Minnesota economy where careers stay here, where businesses are built here. I spent a better part of my life in public relations. This is my 21st year. I started off as a delegate, as a college kid, went into my very first convention. And I've spent my time both in private and public sector as well. Like Jeff said, you're going to see a lot of similarities. But I also have something that a lot of Minnesotans have gone through in the last couple of years. Kim and I sat around our kitchen table when I lost my job in PR. We're always the first to go, we're always the last to come back. You need the accountants and the lawyers to balance the books, but the pretty PR guys are the first ones out the window. There's a lot of Minnesotans struggling. And like Jeff said, we have to connect. I talked to three guys at a hockey game just before I got here. I said, so what would you guys want to hear if you were at the debate tonight? Talk to me about Minnesota competitiveness. I don't want my career at Cargill to be shipped down to Austin, Texas. That'll be my focus. It'll be my sole focus. I balanced the budget. We took a $5 billion deficit into a $3 billion surplus in 2 years and we didn't raise your taxes. I'd appreciate your vote. I'm Kurt Zellers, running for governor.
Dive into our questions tonight. Just a couple of last minute things I'd like to go over. First, if you have your cell phone with you, this is just a friendly reminder to go ahead and turn that on to vibrate. Don't necessarily want you to turn it off though, because if you do have the ability to get on Twitter, our Twitter handle for tonight, our hashtag, is MNGovForum, M-N-G-O-V Forum. So if you think of questions as we proceed tonight, feel free to tweet them out. And if they differ greatly from what I already have here, and they're clever and witty, they might get into the rotation. So I very much appreciate it. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Lastly, I just want to talk a little bit about, you know, this has been built as a forum and not as a debate. What does that mean? Well, in theory, it means that we're here to get introduced to our candidates for governor, and we're hoping that any kind of back and forth and attacks on each other will be deferred until a later date. That we can just take, we can take this night, this moment, to just kind of have a friendly chat and get to know these gentlemen who have stepped out, thrown their hat in the ring for the potential to take on Mark Dayton next year in 2014. So that's the rationale there. That's something that you guys are largely going to have to self-govern. I'll do my part. We are going to have, again, each candidate respond to each question. So there is a little bit of a danger that we might get into the kind of, yeah, what he said thing on the third or fourth guy. Again, that's something you're going to have to self-govern. It's going to be a testament to your creativity, how you're able to add to without necessarily just repeating. So with that said, let's go ahead and get started with a question that I think is pretty good for all four of you to answer because it's tailored to your specific experience and specifically what you bring to the race. We'll start again with Senator Dave Thompson. How does your experience inform your campaign for governor, what you've done so far, your career in the media, and as a legislator?
Well, first off, my career in the media, I hope, has helped me to really gain a good understanding of what I believe and how to explain what I believe in a way that is acceptable to broad groups of people. Because the bottom line is, we're all working very hard to get your support, but in the end, on November of 14, we have to get 50% plus one to beat this governor. And so I hope that it's informed me to do that. In terms of my experience in small business, both as an owner, as an advisor, I think I've learned the value of putting the right people in place. Being governor of a state this size is a very big job. And I believe that it is important that we have a governor with the right vision, with the right beliefs, with the right ideas. But every bit as important is that man or woman's ability to select talent, to vet people, and to get the right folks in place to implement the vision. I've seen very smart business people fail because they didn't bring the right people underneath them. So get elected through sharing my vision, execute the vision through bringing the right people in around me.
By the way, you guys can feel free to, if you want to step up and take the mic, that's fine. If you want to pass it amongst yourselves, that's fine too, whatever's comfortable for you. Mr. Scott Honor, you have a unique story to tell. You ran the Mitt Romney campaign here in Minnesota. Can you talk about how that will inform your experience in this campaign for governor, what lessons you may have learned working for Mitt Romney?
Thanks. You know, I think the fact that, I help lead an organization that bought and fixed 60 companies is actually quite relevant to what we need to do here in the state. We need someone that knows how to lead a team and create real solutions. And I've done that. And I think Mitt Romney's campaign really does give us some lessons that I've taken heed. And in fact, you can learn a little bit about my own views on this by going to www.minnesotamint.com, because we've had a few people make that analogy to me. You know, I think the key thing is, my personal story, I think, is relevant. The fact that, you know, I came from a humble background. I understand what troubles people have. I understand how a tough economy affects lives. And I can personally relate to people that are still going through a lot of those problems in this long, ongoing recession. And I understand that success is what we should all strive for. And in many ways, Mitt didn't do either of those things. He didn't tell his personal story. He didn't embrace his success. I will do that. And I think those lessons are quite relevant to this race.
Hennepin County Commissioner Jeff Johnson, you are in a situation where you find yourself a conservative minority on a largely left-leaning body. How does that experience inform your bid for governor?
Well, it's actually, that's an understatement. But it's been a great learning experience for me, because I spent 6 years in a partisan, an outwardly partisan body, and now I'm on a body that claims to be nonpartisan, even though it's probably just as partisan as the legislature was. And what I have learned is, my 6 years in the legislature, I was in the majority all 6 years. And now I'm not only in the minority, but I'm usually in a minority of one out of seven. And my goal there is not just to fight for things and lose every time. I actually want to accomplish something once in a while. And that takes a kind of a special skill when you're in the minority, when your colleagues have the numbers to defeat absolutely everything you want to do. So I have learned how to cobble together three of my colleagues by figuring out, you know what, we agree on this little thing so I can get it done. I've also learned that when I can't do that, you go to staff and get it done and never tell anybody, which happens to probably be a better way to get it done, and you'll see that as governor.
For Zellers, you absolutely undeniably have been closely involved with the current governor and are familiar with the role between the executive and the legislature. How's that going to inform your bid to be the governor of Minnesota?
Sure, and this is something that I have a unique qualification that, unfortunately, it's not by their looks or their charm or their smarts, it's just by circumstance. I sat across the table from Mark Dayton and negotiated. He wanted a $39 billion budget, then he settled on a $37 billion budget, and the budget that we actually passed was $33 billion. Now, is that too much for me? Absolutely. But I, along with our caucus, were willing to stand there in the gap, shut down government, and if you think it was a fun time, there's a good friend of mine in the audience, Roger Crawford, had hundreds, if not multiple hundreds, of phone calls into his house every night from the union saying, you got to go back and raise taxes. Roger stood strong, we stood strong. You want somebody in this race, folks, Sue Jeffers is right. Somebody who has gone in there and sat toe-to-toe with this guy and won. I have. I'll do the same thing as governor. I will absolutely fight for jobs and a competitive Minnesota economy. And I won't settle for whatever the soup du jour is today. We want this much, but a little bit less. It will be a hard cut. That's the one qualification I have that, unfortunately, my colleagues do not.
All right, we're going to rotate who starts as we go through our actual questions. So the next question will begin with Mr. Scott Honor. I'm going to ask it once, and then each of you can just take your turn, take your minute to answer it. If you need me to repeat it, I will. The question is, defined benefit pension plans for public employees are in trouble all over the country. I'm going to agree on that. As the governor, how would you address the liability of defined benefit pension plans that promise a future payout regardless of market conditions? Mr. Honor.
This is an important topic, and I know something about it. In the business I help run, we raised capital from state employee benefit pension plans and created over $1 billion of gains for state employee pensioners. Our state sits at a $17 billion underfunded gap between its liability and its current level of funding. This is a huge albatross on the neck of our children, and it's an issue that needs to be addressed. And we need to ultimately move our plan from defined benefit to defined contribution, and we need to fix this gap, one of the things that I've been somewhat appalled by, frankly, is that in our government, when we had control of the House and Senate, we let this liability increase. And I think that it's irresponsible for us to not keep our fiscal house in order, including our balance sheet. And this is an issue that we got to further highlight, and I will focus on this and make sure that we leave a good future for our children and give them a balance sheet that they don't have to fund because of our irresponsibility.
Walter, the math of this is simple. The politics of it are extremely difficult when you're talking about pensions and the fact that we have underfunded and in some cases unfunded pension liabilities in the state. What has happened in the past in Minnesota and in most other states in the country is that when the stock market is doing well, we increase the benefits, and when the stock market isn't doing well, the government fills in the hole. Now in 2010, I think it was, we actually took some positive steps, both Republicans and Democrats, to at least for the short term, shore that up. But it's not long term, and it's going to keep going. And so we have to, number one, move to defined contribution plans. But the difficulty is the politics of it, because we know that the DFL is going to protect this with their life. And so you've got to figure out how to force the issue to the people of the state of Minnesota and explain to them exactly what's happening with public employees and how different it is from what they're getting in their own workplace. And then hopefully we'll see some public pressure. I think that's the only way to turn union issues around with the DFL.
As you heard before, we'll see a lot. There's two simple things. First of it is goes to the defined contribution instead of the guaranteed benefit. Because defined benefit would be actually, if we could actually have a baseline, would be great. But it's not. It's a guaranteed benefit. The second thing is you take it out of the politician's hands. You get it away from people in St. Paul and you put it in. You know, no offense, but you give it to somebody like Mr. Honor, who's been in the business community, who actually knows how to follow the market. Because Jeff's exactly right. We got into some of these problems when we started handing out not only the 12th check, but the 13th check. When the stock market was roaring, they handed out 13th checks. Well, last time I checked, there's still only 12 months in a year, so these folks were getting an extra benefit check because he had politicians paying off some of their political allies. Let's not kid ourselves. Aspie and May aren't going to endorse either any of the four of us up here, anybody else that might get in on our side. So you've got to remove the politics and the politicians from the process if you want to actually balance.
I serve on the pension commission. We've got to look at the short-run problem and the long-run problem. The short-run problem is that we're taking individual funds that are struggling and we're asking the statewide taxpayer to fix the problem. We need to stop that. We need to put the consequences of pension decisions on the people who made the decisions. Short-run. Long-run, we do need to convert from a defined benefit program to a defined contribution program. In other words, we don't guarantee a payout at the end, but rather, just like most of you, if not all in this room, you know what you put into your pension, and then the outcome is dependent upon the quality of the investments and the like. The problem is that creates a funding issue, because all of a sudden you're trying to make this conversion, and you've still got all of these retirees coming into the system that have been promised something. So 2 days after the session, I, along with Senator Roger Chamberlain, made a trip to Chicago to talk about a way to use an insurance tool in an attempt to fund the transition and fund the pensions with no additional tax revenue. Now, we're having that vetted through attorneys and bond people, but I'll be talking about that as this campaign goes on. That's what we've got to do, is find a way to make that transition, but stop holding Minnesota taxpayers hostage.
The next question we'll start with Hennepin County Commissioner Jeff Johnson. I don't know who submitted these questions, but this one might have came from U.S. candidate Mike McFadden, because it starts, declared Republican U.S. Senate candidate Mike McFadden talks a lot about the success of the Cristo Rey High School in Minneapolis. Cristo Rey achieves perfect graduation rates, and this past year, 100% college placement rates for all graduating seniors. Very impressive. They achieved these results with half of the per pupil spending as compared to Minneapolis, and they do not cherry pick students. What is the state's role in K-12 education, and what are your views on achieving greater results without driving the cost of education up any further?
Thank you. Well, the achievement gap between white students and students of color, as many of you know, is the worst in the nation in Minnesota. We have been throwing money at it, we've been wringing our hands about it for decades, and we haven't changed a dang thing, which I think is just shameful in this state. Crystal Ray is a great example that you can take those same kids that some people apparently are assuming can't succeed, and they can succeed. And you see the same thing at Best Academy and Harvest Prep. There are a lot of examples for that. We have to empower parents. I don't know if any of you have heard of the parent trigger, but I think that is a great option where if your kids are in a failing school, the parents actually get to vote, a vote of confidence or no confidence in that administration. And if by some majority they vote no confidence, then something statutorily has to happen, like vouchers, like replacement of the administration, like the school changes to a charter school. There are like ideas all over the country like that, some from Democrats, some from Republicans. We need to take them, and we need to just keep trying them until we find out how to start closing the gap in the state, because it's just unacceptable.
And in 1 minute less, that's what I said to Jeff. There are any number, and this is an issue very passionate for me. My wife Kim, and I think the majority of us up here have spouses who are teachers. Her teaching degree is early childhood, K through six. As a union certified teacher in Robbinsdale School District, we live school choice. We send Reagan and Will to a charter school, Beacon Academy, and my wife goes into the same teacher's lounge as Tom Dewar's wife, as proud as she can be, holds her head high and says, yes, I send my children to a school choice school. We need to give every kid the exact same opportunity in the exact same state. We should be outraged. We should be absolutely ticked off that we have half of the room. If you divide it down the middle in some of our schools, you all graduate. Congratulations, you get a life. You all over here, I'm sorry, you're going to be caught in the system. Round and round you go. That is absolutely going to be something that I and I think all these guys are going to absolutely focus on. We should not give up on one single kid. Every kid has the ability to not only graduate, to become successful, and to be a contributing citizen in the state of Minnesota. It will be one of my top priorities.
There are a number of ways to accomplish school choice. I've become a fan of tuition tax credits. And so that a person has the ability to deduct from their taxes, take a credit from their taxes for tuition paid to a school of their choice. Now, the problem with that is that we have folks who do not pay sufficient state income taxes to benefit from it. So I've looked at some information from the Cato Institute and other places that indicate what you can do is set up a big tax credit in the range of 90% or even more so that businesses can contribute to a fund that the money is then given to children who come from families where they don't have sufficient income to take advantage of the tax credits. But the bottom line is we've got to have choice, we've got to have competition, because we all believe, I believe in this room, that that iron sharpens iron, that the reason we have great retailers and great businesses of all kinds is competition. So why wouldn't we do that with our schools? We need to do tuition tax credits, and then we need to make sure that we don't bind these schools with the government regulations that prevent us from instituting discipline. Other things.
Minnesota had the first charter schools ever. Today, we rank dead last in the country in minority graduation rates. I think that's totally unacceptable. Jamie and I support KIPP, which is a charter school in North Minneapolis. It's a middle school, fifth through eighth grade. It operates at a 25% lower cost per student than the public schools nearby, pays teachers 15% more, and has twice the outcome in test score proficiency as the nearby public school. We need more of that. I had an opportunity a couple months ago to spend some time with Governor Bobby Jindal and his staff to discuss education. And there's a point here that other Republican governors, the 30 Republican governors around the country, are doing some really smart things in education and in other areas. And in Louisiana, they're really leading the nation in some great innovative ideas. And I want to take good ideas, whether they're generated within this state or in other states, and apply them here in Minnesota.
As Republicans, we often talk about cutting spending, reducing rates, and creating efficiency in government. In order to do that, budget priorities have to be set. With that in mind, what principles would you bring to bear in trying to develop your proposed budget as governor of Minnesota?
Sure, and we actually put into law two defining principles. One was the Sunset Commission, which said, take average Minnesotans, bring them to the Capitol, business owners, accountants, lawyers, you name it, have them come down, look at these agencies, and nobody's budget is guaranteed. King Banyan, a great member of our caucus, who's a St. Cloud State professor, brought down these ideas and actually worked on them. And then the second priority is you start with a baseline that everybody comes in and proves that their budget is worthwhile. If you had a 10% budget surplus at the end of last year and spent it all off at the end of the year so that you could come back next year and get a 3% increase, that's not going to be rewarded. And then you start by actually shrinking the size of government. Keith Downey, another one of our members of our caucus, had a 15 by 15. Reduce the state workforce 15% by 2015. Now, we didn't get quite there, but we did get an 8% reduction in the state workforce. That's a great start as far as I'm concerned, and we used common sense principles that we learned from Deloitte, from Arthur Anderson, IBM. We brought them to the Capitol. We showed what other businesses in other states have been successful. We made government more efficient and more effective.
Principle number one, always ask yourself, is this a task that the private sector could do? If the answer is yes, don't have government do it. The government ought to provide public services, those things that will not be provided in the private sector and that benefit all people equally. That takes you to your second principle, and that is that you don't pick winners and losers. You don't pick businesses that you subsidize and businesses that you penalize, individuals that you like their behavior, therefore you tax them less, and individuals that you don't like their behavior, and therefore you tax them more. So what you do is you try to create a friendly playing field for all the people working out there in the economy, because we all know that for families sitting at their kitchen table on Sunday night trying to figure out how to balance their budget, it's a lot easier if you have a good job. And the way we have good jobs is to create a growing, thriving economy that benefits all of us, and we try to benefit all of our employers, all of our employees in the state, and keep government limited to its proper role.
I think we have to start the conversation about the budget with the conversation about results. All too often, I hear politicians speak in terms of the dollars they're spending as if that guarantees a result. We all know that's not the case. I think we have to measure what we're getting today, have a conversation about where we want to go in terms of what results we want to get, and create a path to get there. And that's what I did in business. You know, when we bought and fixed those 60 companies, every one of those companies had an opportunity to see loaded administrative costs reduced. I'd say on average we reduced costs by about 10%. There's no question in my mind that this state's government is run less effectively than any one of those companies. And so I know that we can get in and, on the one hand, get better results for citizens of this state, but do so in a way that we reduce costs. But we got to get under the covers by department and really have a reset of what we're doing here with this government. And we need the transparency that everyone in this state deserves so that we all see what's going on. I'll bring that to St. Paul.
Walter, this is my life on the Hennepin County Board. Because we spend, and the state is no different, it's probably worse, but we spend so much money on so many programs because they make us feel like we're doing something. And it's hard to say we shouldn't do them anymore because we're going to get attacked for not caring about a certain group of people. And that has to stop. Minnesotans are very generous, and I think most of us are willing to pay taxes to help the least fortunate get on their feet. But so many of the programs we fund at both the county and state level, they don't produce that result. So question number one, should government be doing it at all? And once we decide that government should be doing it, then we need to make every program prove that they're actually producing the results that we claim to want, that they're actually helping the people that we claim they're supposed to be helping, that they're actually moving people off of welfare to self-sufficiency for the long term, not for a few months until they go back onto welfare. We can't be measuring programs by how many people are served, but by how many lives are changed.
The Met Council. Appointed by the governor with Regional Development and Taxing Authority, and I'll add to this question that they are expanding. In my county, or Wright County, they're looking to get their mitts in there, and I think their grand plan is to take over St. Cloud and, you know, basically just eventually become the state. With that in mind, what actions specifically would you support to rein in the Met Council?
Here, here. Well, first off, the Met Council is a headless monster that is driving so much policy that is ridiculous. And I've been on this since my many days on the radio years and years ago. So first thing you do as governor is you replace the members of the Met Council with people that have that are like-minded and philosophically believe what we do. So they stop engaging in mischief as quickly as possible. Now, obviously, those folks have to be confirmed by the Senate, but you appoint people that are philosophically with you. That's the short run issue. The second issue is you cut it back to its original intent. The idea of these kinds of planning agencies for metropolitan areas were to, you know, the bus service and making certain that our infrastructure, the core infrastructure, sewer, and those kinds of things, that we coordinate that between different suburbs and the major cities. That makes sense. They have no business in planning, in affordable housing, in deciding what kind of transportation we have. We need to bring them down to a fraction of what they're currently doing.
Yeah.
Well, I'd start by asking the question of, should the Met Council exist? And I think there's a broader point here, which is, as we look to reset government, we really have to question, what is it that we want to get out of government? And what's the best way to get that? And I see our government today really being built through a series of band-aid fixes and an approach that's been built without anyone really questioning why we're doing it for decades. So I would start by questioning that. Now, if you took the Met Council as it is today, I'd start by reducing the number of people on its board.
Yeah.
And when I oversaw companies, you know, my general view is a board of three people is pretty darn effective. Five, you probably can have still, you know, some people adding value. If you get much beyond that, you're not getting a lot of extra value. And I saw the governor just, you know, as he increased spending in education by almost $500 million, he went out and asked for 80 people to join various boards and groups focused on education. But there's no way 80 people can do anything effectively. We need a lot less of that.
Specifically, what would I do? Step number one, try to eliminate it. But if the political will, isn't there to do it, and it probably wouldn't be with the DFL Senate, then you do two other things in the meantime, but I think you constantly talk about its elimination. Number one, you statutorily restrict its power back to what it was intended for originally. I think Sue usually says flushes and buses, and that makes some sense. Having some sort of regional authority for that probably makes some sense. But then I think equally important, you cannot have unelected people levying property taxes. That is just a you can either elect them, or you can take that power away and give it to the elected legislature and governor. I think the second one's probably the better option, but an election is possible. When I was first elected to the House, all the Republicans, when Jesse was governor, we ran on let's elect the Met Council. Then Tim Pawlenty won, and we said, oh, he gets to appoint him. We don't want to do that anymore. Save for a few of us. If it's good for one party, it's good for the other. They shouldn't be taxing us.
And I come from the school of learning by those well-intended ideas. I was on that bandwagon. I learned at the foot of Phil Krakey, the Met Council is always wrong. If you remember anything else, Representative Zellers, the Met Council is always wrong. First, you defund it, you take away their money. The second thing is you reduce their charge. You eliminate their ability to raise taxes without going to the voter or without coming to the legislature and saying, should we be doing this? Should we be spending the money on it? Thirdly, you cut the board in half. Scott's right, they are way too many people down there. And they are like this. Well, it's not me, it's him that's doing it over there. It's not her, it's him over there. They're the ones that approved it. I have nothing to do with it. It is the quintessential government bureaucracy. Unelected, has taxing authority over each and every one of us in here. And to your point, they're exporting their horrible ideas all over the state now. The wheelage fee came from Hennepin County and from the Met Council. That's a horrible idea. You first, you defund it. You second, you take away their taxing authority. Third, you cut the board in half. And when you're done with that, you make them come back to the legislature. And ultimately, you make the citizens approve their budgets for a referendum.
All right, so we that was a nice rah-rah, we all agreed question. Let's switch it up a bit and get a little bit more pragmatic. So the likelihood is that if any one of you is elected to be governor, you're going to be dealing with divided government. We'll concede that possibility for the sake of this question. With that in mind, what's your view of the virtue of bipartisanship? And how would you approach divided government?
I'm looking to be governor of the 5.3 million people in the state and make this state better for everyone. And in order to do that, I think what we need to do as Republicans, and this is true with respect to our state and frankly in a broader conversation, is we have to do a better job of conveying why our ideas really are the best ideas for everyone. And so a big part of that in my mind is about messaging and really about showing people what are we getting today out of government and why we should all demand to get more. And let's create a common focus on getting better results. In my business career, in order to fix those companies that we fixed, you had to work with a wide range of constituents. You had to work with employees, managers, vendors, lenders, customers. And I'll take those skills of coming to solutions and doing so in a way that focuses on the priorities and compromises when appropriate to get the job done that's going to make this state better for everyone.
Well, you know, I'm in this to actually change the direction of government. We watch when Democrats have a share of power, they move things in a liberal direction just as fast as they can. And then when we get our share of power, we tend to slow it down. But we're always moving in the same direction. And I think it's time we had a governor that actually turns it around. We cannot continue to grow the size and scope and power of government just at a slower pace than the Democrats. However, it's not a likelihood, it's a certainty that we will, if one of us is elected, we'll have divided government because the DFL will stay, the DFL Senate is enough. So we know you'll have a DFL Senate, we will hopefully have a Republican House. And my goal, some of you saw my video, I'm not in this to be a goalie and just stop the bad stuff and never change the direction. Because they'll take over again at some point and keep moving in their government growth direction. And so you've got to figure out how to pick off, frankly, enough Democrats to change the direction. I was able to do that when I was in the House with the DFL Senate. I took some of the most difficult free market legislation and we got it done. And I'll do the same thing as governor.
In a lot of cases, actions speak louder than words. Of the major legislation I sponsor, there's three big pieces I think that speak volumes. You go get Democrat authors not only to sign onto your bill, but to help you pass it. After the Drew Shadeen case, a student that was just a heinous crime, poor girl was raped, murdered, and took across state lines. That guy got out of prison because we didn't have life in prison for violent sex offenders. I went and worked with a former St. Paul prosecutor named John Lesh, probably one of the most leftist guys you'll find at the Capitol, and worked with my fellow Republicans. We passed some landmark legislation that was actually copied all around the country in locking up violent sex offenders. The second thing was something that was much more regional. I didn't think would be so difficult, but it was a Maple Grove hospital. In Minnesota, I know everybody's gonna be shocked, you have to get permission from the state to build a hospital in the fastest growing suburb in the state. Unbeknownst to me, well, there's people in Wyoming, there's people up on the Iron Range that don't necessarily care if Maple Grove has a new hospital. So they aren't necessarily opposed to it, but they're disinterested. I got not only those folks on the Iron Range, but all across Minnesota and St. Paul to vote with me and pass the Maple Grove Hospital.
Well, first off, this question really is about how do we hold to what we believe in, but get the people's business done? And in order to do that, you have to understand that you've got to be willing to stand for your principles, but not everything's a principle. So you have to pick those things that are important, that you are willing to die on the hill for, and not give in on, but stand by them. And then you have to work in the other areas where you're able to do that. I was chief author of some legislation in the Senate when we were in the majority, and life was good because that man was the speaker instead of in the minority. And that legislation required an audit of our public employees to make certain that the people who they claimed to be dependents actually were dependents. And I was able to make enough of a case to other Democrats that this governor ended up signing that. And the auditors reported that in the first year, that saved the taxpayer $4 million. So we can reach across the aisle and do these things. And finally, I just returned from having the honor of serving on an emerging legislator seminar out in the state of Virginia. And I was nominated for that by a Democrat, Senator Ann West. So you stick to your principles, but you work with people.
As governor, what reform, if any, would you propose to Minnesota's health care exchange, which is being implemented? Should we pause for a boo there? I'll start the question over. As governor, what reform, if any, would you propose to Minnesota's health care exchange, which is being implemented as part of Obamacare?
So you don't like the health care exchange? All right, let me start out with this. The health care exchange cannot be fixed. And some people are suggesting that we need to fix it. It can't be fixed. And that we kind of have this quaint belief by some people that if we pay for it as state taxpayers and design it as state taxpayers, it's a state health care exchange. It's not. It's a federal health care exchange, just like every other health care exchange in the country, and we ought to let the federal government design it and pay for it. So I would have vetoed it, step number one. But the question is, in 2015, when I'm governor then, and it's in place, what do you do about it? And my gut reaction to that is, you work from day one to eliminate it, but knowing that you're gonna have a DFL Senate and the political will won't be there to eliminate it for at least 2 years, then you at least try to minimize the damage. But you do that always with the goal of eventually eliminating it and moving towards a more free market healthcare system in Minnesota.
We actually had this question before. So Speaker Mark Dayton came to me each and every day and said, we want the healthcare exchange passed, we want it now. I said, no, we will not be doing a healthcare exchange. Jeff is exactly right. There is no fix for it. They're spending $50 to $100 million. They just got another $60 million from the federal government because they still screwed it up so badly. They still can't get it fixed. They need another $60 million from the federal government. You can't fix it. You start by defunding it. You start by pulling the staff away, and then you offer a solution. Because as Republicans, we can't always be the party of no. We have to offer a solution. We actually have offered these solutions. I'm pretty sure Dave voted for it when we were in the majority, to allow any insurance company, just like if it was car insurance, just like if it was insurance for whatever business you have, anyone should be able to come into our state and offer services. We have United Healthcare right here in our very own state, one of the best and highest rated insurance companies on average by their consumers, cannot sell insurance in the state of Minnesota. You open the market up, it will drive down the price. That's my solution. That's what we would move for. That's an alternative to a government-funded bureaucracy.
The answer is get rid of the health care exchange. And the Democratic Senate won't do it. But the very least I think we could do is convince people that we should not take our mandates and our burdens beyond the requirements of the federal government. And in some instances, that piece of legislation did that. So the bottom line is we need to win two elections to succeed on this. We need a Republican governor and a Republican House following the 14 election, and then we need to change the Senate over in the 2016 election. At that point, we can get rid of this thing. And oh, by the way, let's remember, there is no such thing as a health care exchange if it weren't for this mess called the Affordable Care Act, known as Obamacare. And so, unfortunately, our U.S. Supreme Court, in what I consider to be a wrong-headed decision, found that piece of legislation to be constitutional. So I think anybody who becomes the governor of this state needs to work with other governors around the country to push back extremely hard on the federal government and say, this is not an acceptable way to force people in our states to do business, because it's our job as your governor to defend you.
Well, we are going to have the exchange, so we're going to have to look at what it looks like then to figure out what we do. I've started, acquired, and consolidated software companies as part of my career. And there very well may be an opportunity to combine our exchange with that of other states and do something to smartly reduce costs. But we also have to focus on other places we can reduce costs. I've gotten to know Dr. Jeff Collier, the Lieutenant Governor of Kansas. So he's a surgeon and also Lieutenant Governor. He created what is probably one of the most forward-looking healthcare plans in Kansas, where they reduced their Medicaid costs by about 10% and did it while improving outcomes. And they did it by bringing competition into the state. We need to do the same thing here. We need to leverage our ability to allow free market principles to come into our healthcare plans, change eligibility requirements, have recipients really have skin in the game and be responsible for their own wellness in a way that reduces costs, and do everything we can to simultaneously improve outcomes and reduce costs.
As an activist, I frequently come in contact with folks who are outside of the Republican Party. They hold to conservative principles, or they just don't like the direction things are going. How do you plan to attract independents, folks who are not currently involved in the political process, and disaffected Republicans, people who have left the party?
I think a lot of it is what we did tonight. I'm standing on the boards at a hockey rink talking to five other dads and a couple of moms that are watching the hockey game and talking about, so what are you doing tonight? I'm going to debate. What are you going to talk about? What would be important to you? If you start with the old principle that Norm Coleman said, you got 2 ears, the good Lord gave you 2 ears and 1 mouth. If you use it with proportion, you're going to be good at what you do. I think that's the first thing. The second thing is we've got to relate. We've got to be relatable to them. We've got to offer a choice. I think we need economic opportunity, personal opportunity, and education opportunity for all Minnesotans. It's not a Republican or Democrat issue. Quite frankly, I'm awfully ticked off as a middle-class citizen that Barack Obama and Mark Dayton talk about how they're representing Kim and I each and every day. They have no clue what we in the middle class go through. I highly doubt that Mark Dayton went out and spent 2 hours on the phone trying to find a deal on a set of 20-inch Coopers for his wife's car. Actually, his wife probably bought him the car and drove us up. But we've got to be able to relate to Minnesotans in a way that most of them are going through their life. I think that's what I can offer.
You know, I think people are looking for leadership. And leadership means understanding the people that you're working for. And let's face it, public servants work for the people. And I hope whoever is elected keeps that in mind. Then secondly, most people are with us on the issues. Think about it. What do we believe? We believe that individuals ought to work hard, that they ought to do the best that they can. That for those people who are infirm, the young, that are vulnerable, the young, the elderly, the infirm, obviously we've got to give them a hand up and take care of them. I don't think anything that I just stated takes us out of the mainstream. I think it puts us squarely in the mainstream. So now back to the bold leadership. We can't back down when the attacks come. I can assure you, whichever of the four of us ends up being the candidate, they're going to come after us. And we have to be willing to stand up and say, listen, you are not going to paint me that way. I care about people. I care about students and having them get a good education and people having a good job. And here's what we expect of people and here's how we can do it. And that kind of a leadership will attract people to you. And I'm telling you, that's the majority of Minnesotans.
I think we have to start by all working together as Republicans. So we all share our principles. We focus together on a common set of objectives, but we have a great opportunity here to win this election. As I've toured the state, I've heard a groundswell of emotion from citizens all over the state, including independents and Democrats, saying that they're tired of politicians continuing to make bad decisions and doing it in a way that furthers their political careers instead of looking out for the interests of Minnesotans. And I think having an objective of focusing on jobs, how to make the economy get it better, how to focus on outcomes in education, helping the needy with a view of a handout, not a handout, moving people from welfare to work. Those objectives are shared by all Minnesotans. We'll be talking about results in a way that I think we can take the third of the state that are Republicans and work together with the other two thirds to take this state back for ourselves.
I think when you're looking at independents and some Democrats, number one, we have to give them a really clear, positive choice. What Ronald Reagan said, bold colors, not soft pastels. They have to see the differences between us as Republicans and Democrats, and we have to present it to them in a positive way. I talk to my neighbors, who I'd say are probably more likely than not independents and cross party lines all the time, and they tell me, you know what, I'm willing to pay taxes, but God darn it, I think government just doesn't spend our money wisely. And sometimes they say, and I don't think Republicans care about the average guy. You guys are always out to help your rich friends. And so we've got to address that in how we talk about the issues. When we're talking about smaller government, it can't just be we're going to cut programs. We got to talk about we are going to fund those programs that actually do for people what we say we want them to do. We got to look inside out. We're going to eliminate the programs that actually are bad for people and maybe redirect some of that money in the programs that actually work. So you present a choice and you give them a positive option to listen to, and I think we'll do great next year with independents.
Government shutdowns, something that we've become familiar with here in the state of Minnesota. We're now currently talking about potentially facing on the federal level yet again. As governor, how would you regard the threat of a state government shutdown? Is it something that is a legitimate part of the legislative process, or does it constitute a failure, and if so, by whom?
We have a constitutional responsibility in Minnesota to reach a budget solution every other year. And that is what we should always attempt to do. And we should always be working very hard to make sure that that budget solution is reached before the end of the session, before the constitutional deadline of the session. Now, in my opinion, the shutdown obviously occurred for a number of reasons, but a big one was a failure of leadership on the part of this governor. The fact of the matter is that this governor changed his tune many times along the way. I can't count the number of times that our leadership in the Senate, I'm sure the Speaker at the time could corroborate this, came in and said, we thought we had something with this governor, there was a complete shift of thinking, and we had no idea that it was coming. So first off, I think leadership and clear thinking can help us prevent that sort of thing from happening. Can I conceive of a scenario where you have to have a government shutdown? Yes. If you have to defend the very people that are paying the bills for government, sometimes you have to do it. But as governor, I can assure you, I would come out early, I would be clear, I would negotiate and make every effort I could to get our work done on time.
Our state government spends 2.5 times as much per citizen as it did in 1980. Our government is getting out of control. We have too much money being wasted, we're not getting good outcomes. We'll focus on results and absolutely reduce the total dollars spent by government. And none of this rhetoric about decreasing the rate of spending increases. I'm talking about really cutting what we spend. And I think we lost a great opportunity when our party had control of the House and Senate, and we went all the way to a government shutdown. We still increased spending. And we have that opportunity there to decrease spending. That's what we should do. And if it takes a government shutdown to get it done, well, that's a tool that the governor has. And while there are places where we need to compromise because we're going to focus on results in a way that hopefully builds consensus around the state, a tool the governor absolutely has is approving the budget. And I will stand strong to make sure that we focus not only on improving outcomes, but reduce the total dollars spent in this state.
Here, here.
I don't think a government shutdown should ever be just accepted as a normal part of government, because it clearly is a failure on the part of a lot of parties involved. And I was in the legislature during a very, very short government shutdown, so I don't cast blame on others. But I don't think we should ever accept it as something that's just acceptable and part of the process. However, as governor, I don't think you stand up and say, I am never going to allow a government shutdown, which I think Mark Dayton said something like that before he allowed a government shutdown. But I think it's important to have as part of your negotiating tool as a governor, because there are going to be very significant differences. As I mentioned before, we cannot continue to grow the size and scope and power of government, but I can guarantee you that's what the DFL Senate's going to want to do those first 2 years if one of us is governor. And you need to have a couple chips to hold in order to actually change the direction. So would I favor a government shutdown? Of course not. But would I say we'll never have one? No, I wouldn't say that.
As someone who experienced it most recently, it absolutely isn't something you want. You don't want to be a story across the country that you couldn't get your job done. But as Dave said, I'm sorry, Senator Thompson, he's a friend, so if you don't mind, I'll call you Dave. You stand on principle, and our principle was we were not going to raise your taxes to balance the budget. We weren't going to do it. Now, again, poor Roger Crawford sat there for hours and hours at night when they funneled call after call and calling him names, saying all kinds of horrible things to him. And then a few union Democrats would say, you know what, I'm with you. Don't start government up again. You're spending too much. You stand on those principles. And, you know, for me personally, it wasn't a matter of questioning whether it should be raised this tax or that fee. Should I vote for a health impact fee or some wheelage fee? No, it was we were going to raise taxes to balance the budget. Whether that meant pressure for 10 days, 21 days, 31 days, 41 days. But I don't think it should be where we start. You lay out your budget early on. You actually provide specifics on what your priorities are. You show those priorities, and then you allow for a good time of negotiation. Not like Governor Dayton, where the budget he agreed to the day before the shutdown, or excuse me, after the shutdown, was the budget we presented the day before. Didn't have to happen.
All right, now this question relates to your role. If you're elected governor, you kind of become the de facto leader of the Republican Party in the state of Minnesota. So that's the context here. Among the scandals currently plaguing Washington, we have learned that the National Security Administration is collecting the phone records of all Americans. Michigan Representative Justin Amash presented an amendment which would have required the FISA court to issue warrants only when information pertaining to individuals under direct investigation for a crime. The entire Republican congressional delegation, including Representatives John Klein, Eric Paulson, and Michelle Bachmann, voted against the Amash Amendment, and thus to sustain domestic spying against American citizens. If this had occurred while you were governor, while you were effectively the leader of the Republican Party of Minnesota, how would you have responded to this development?
As governor, and as a Republican, I want to support our Republican congresspeople and our future upcoming Republican senator, which I am highly confident we'll have. But I would want to leave federal issues to those representing us in Washington. And I'm certainly a fervent believer in the 10th Amendment and would look to see our state and myself as governor focus on the state issues that affect us. I think the idea of having government more involved in our lives is not one that I'm at all in favor of, and so I'll look as a general matter to protect individual rights and keep government focused on the business the government is there for in the first place. And I think as Republicans, we need to show consensus and support for our leaders in Washington and stay strong on these issues.
My gut reaction on this NSA issue and the Amash Amendment is based upon what I know about it, which is the same thing you all know about it. What I've read in the paper is I probably would have supported it because I think it is ridiculous how large and intrusive government has gotten. However, as governor, it's not a federal issue, and I'm not going to make a practice out of attacking my fellow Republican office holders as governor of Minnesota. I don't think that's positive for us as a party. However, if asked, I'm going to share my opinion because I think that that is something that does affect Minnesotans. The size and scope and power and intrusiveness of government. Now, the one thing I would say about this issue is my gut reaction is that I would have supported the Amash Amendment. There are many Republicans in Congress who I respect that didn't vote for it. And I do question whether they had some classified information that the rest of us don't have. And I would always hold that back and say, you know what, maybe there's something someone could tell me to feel otherwise. But as a gut reaction is, I would have been a yes on that.
Yeah, I would actually start the process before this, before you get to a vote, before you get a reaction, before you get a microphone in your face saying, why would you support what Congresswoman Bachman, Klein, and Paulson all supported? I would start with calling and asking him, why? You know, what are you seeing on this vote? Where do you think this is going? What is it related to? And to Jeff's point, if it's something that was going to be my exact answer as well, is there something that we don't know? Is there something that you're told in these committees? Because folks, there are a lot of secret, double secret probation things that they're told that we don't ever get to hear about. And if it is a matter of national security that they're using it for, I'd be willing to listen. But I'm with Jeff. My gut says they've stepped too far. That's fine to go after terrorists. That's fine. And you know what? Quite frankly, if you want to look at my emails and my cell phone, there's nothing exciting on there. But I don't think you should have carte blanche to go walking through my email, Kim's email, anyone in this room's email, just because you think you might have something there. It should be focused on the criminals, but I would start with a phone call to our delegation, ask them why they're going down this road long before the vote ever came up.
Those of you who remember me from the radio remember that I was a civil libertarian when being a civil libertarian wasn't cool. Remember the names Hamdi and Padilla? Two American citizens who were held on suspicion of terrorism by our criminal justice system and denied their Fourth and Fifth Amendment rights. That shouldn't happen in this country. I'm not allowed to criticize our congressional delegation, but I will tell you what I think. And what I think is that if the huge hammer of the federal government and their criminal prosecution arm is going to be used against you, there better be cause to do it. And as your governor, I stand up for you. Because I agree it is a federal issue, but I believe when the 10th Amendment is infringed, when my citizens' rights are infringed under the 9th and 10th Amendments, it becomes my business.
For expanding or funding regional rail for the likes of
Okay. Before I said this was my life on the Hennepin County Board, this is really my life on the Hennepin County Board. Because I'm on a board where six of the seven of us happen to believe that if it's rail related, you fund it. And here's my thought on rail. It is unbelievably not cost effective. And if it was, I would consider it. But I've never seen a proposal for light rail, for commuter rail, for quote unquote high speed rail that is cost effective. My policy with respect to transportation is let's figure out ways for people to get where they want to go when they want to go there. We sometimes call that mobility. If you had a rail line that actually did that, that actually relieved congestion in any considerable way, that's something that we ought to consider. But we still haven't seen one. We actually had a commissioner from Olmsted County come and talk to us as a Hennepin County board about the high-speed rail from Chicago through Rochester. And he said, this one will be cost-effective. And I said, really? How do you know that? Well, I've talked to people, and they said they'd ride it. That's as good as it gets. So I am not in favor of expanding this any further than it already is.
No. And actually, probably sitting up here, I probably voted against more light rail lines than any other, again, by circumstance. I didn't like North Star. I didn't think it was going to pay off. And nobody likes to be the smart aleck in the room that says, I told you so. But it doesn't work. Southwest Line's not going to work. The one between the downtowns, maybe can get to 50%. I actually am in favor of transit, though, and Maple Grove is a perfect example of bus rapid transit. We are not in the union system. We are a Maple Grove line. We have actually not only broken even, but in some cases actually made enough money to pay for the next shelter, the bus shelter that we're going to be proposed. And if you site it the right way, like we did in downtown Maple Grove, it's right next to the movie theater, right next to the restaurant. So on the weekdays, it's all full of consumers. And I've ridden it when I worked in the PR firm downtown. Get on the bus, half hour later, you're down there. You read emails, you do whatever. But in the weekends, the garage is still there. And now our business owners, when they have customers coming in, they approve it. It's the only way. And by the way, while we're building then more roads for cars, the buses can drive on the shoulders. But I'm not going to vote for the rail.
see a liberal talking about the economy, they're always talking about wealth redistribution, because they tend to value equality over prosperity. Likewise, when you hear them talking about transportation, they're typically talking about trying to govern you as to how you should commute, rather than meeting the demand how you want to commute. So that's why these things don't work. We're trying to get people to engage in behavior that they don't want to engage in. And so it simply doesn't work. The trains are not full. Obviously, buses don't require the huge upfront capital layout. It's easier to adjust schedules based upon demand. I will not be voting for or promoting as governor trains.
Well, when companies are thinking about locating in Minnesota, one thing I can tell you for sure is they're not thinking, well, geez, they got light rail, so therefore we want to come here. But they do pay attention to how long it takes to get from the airport to their hotel. And you try doing that during rush hour. We need to focus on infrastructure. We need to have a smart plan that focuses on how we create a state that has a pro-business environment and one that is ready for long-term growth, and we have to be smart about how we spend money to do that. But it's got to be a comprehensive plan. I think we have to put transportation infrastructure high on the priority list. We're behind the times. It's not about rail. It's about smartly expanding our roads and other infrastructure, and doing that with a prioritization of taking bloated administrative costs out of government and allocating them. This idea of funding things on a one-off basis, that makes no sense. We ought to put everything into one bucket, put transportation resources high on the list, and then figure out what we're going to do over the long term.
A follow-up question to that, trying to extract a principle from this question of transportation. There was an NPR article recently that indicated that over the years, however, whatever the period of time, there are a lot more private vehicles on the road as opposed to public transportation, which, you know, I would score as a win for prosperity and economic freedom. But the Department of Transportation here in Minnesota has an explicit policy of halting the development of further lanes in favor of public transportation, trains, what have you. What are your thoughts on the use of government as a means to engineer behavior?
So just the other morning, I was leaving a meeting, went down by 169 and 494. The fact that they have figured out to put three turnarounds in less than a half mile shows you exactly what they're trying to do. Did anybody in here try to do a turnaround? Anybody get wrong, lost, comes the wrong way in the turnaround? That's government engineering's best. Come out to the suburbs and try and get out of a parking lot when you're leaving after you've done your shopping. It's socially engineered so you go one way. Again, and I'm a farm kid, so trying to get me out of my truck is going to be really hard. But I got on a bus because the time was right. There was a purpose where I went from one location downtown, didn't stop along the way, so it wasn't a waste of my time. I think that's where you offer the choices to citizens. But it has to be road miles. You know, the three of us from Hennepin County drive up and down 494. We needed the third lane finished on 494 for so long, I can't even begin. As a staffer in 1994 for Senator Grams, we followed the last line of 610 up to 169. We need road miles. We don't need any more of the social engineering. And it should start with roads. It should end with transit.
You know, it's hard in these nuts and bolts transportation issues to put my nerd on, but I think we can hear. The founding fathers were so insightful by emphasizing the importance of the individual. Now, how does that relate to transportation? How it relates to transportation is if we make the individual the focus of society rather than the collective, rather than the government, then we let individuals determine how they would like to transport themselves, and the government provides it accordingly. Rather than the government being the preeminent authority in life, attempting to dictate to people how they ought to travel. So really, it's no more complicated than that. We should not be engineering behavior. We as conservatives believe that the way a society is best ordered is to allow all the individuals to make decisions in pursuit of their own self-interest, of course, with moral underpinnings and rules and laws in place, and then society has the best outcome if government stays out of the way.
So when we bought and fixed companies, one of the most critical things to do, and one of the most challenging things to do, is change the culture of the company. And it's really important to do that. We need that in government. We need the government to have a view that the citizens of this state are its customer.
Yes. Yes.
And as it relates to transportation, the government's job should be to give its customers what they want. And I would make sure that that's a priority. As an aside, I would say the government ought to take a different tact in thinking about roads and cars and whatnot. I drove here in my Ford pickup truck that runs on natural gas. You can buy natural gas at the retail pump at $2 a gallon. I pay about 40 cents a gallon filling it up at my house. It's 90% lower emissions. Now, I wonder why our governor is harming our environment and wasting our money by not driving all of the state vehicles on natural gas. Try to figure out how much that saves us. Turns out it's a state secret. They won't tell us how many vehicles we own. So if anyone has a way to figure out how many dump trucks we have in the state, I'd like to know. But that's where our priorities ought to be.
I think this is a great example of what I think is the biggest problem with government right now, even more so than runaway spending, and that is this desire for government to use our tax money to influence everything we do. What we eat, what we drink, where we live, how we travel, how big our bodies, how we raise our kids, whether we're able to have any guilty pleasures left in life at all. And again, I see this constantly on the county board because it happens first at the local level and it's very, very pernicious. And it is the biggest problem we have right now. And so you can look at it from the standpoint of transit versus roads, or you can look at it from the standpoint of the SHIP program where we're spending a ton of money trying to teach people how to be healthier because government knows best. This is something I think that our next governor needs to talk about constantly. It's not the proper role of government to be using our money to influence how we decide to live our lives and raise our own families.
You knew this question was coming. If you do not receive the endorsement of the Minnesota Republican Party to be its gubernatorial candidate, would you run against the endorsed candidate in the primary election? Why or why not?
No, I will not. I will abide by the endorsement. All Minnesotans matter. All conservatives matter. All Republicans matter. So I am certainly not going to be speaking to any one group on the campaign trail. As I go around, I'm going to talk about all of the issues that we care about. And different Republicans, different conservatives have different issues that are a priority for them. But in my view, having grown up spending a lot of time thinking about working in for and talking with the Republican Party, what I know is the people who go out on that cold day in February, and then they go to their BPOU convention, and they agree to become delegates to the state convention, and they maybe stay there till the wee hours of the morning, they're the folks that built the operation. And I'm not going to look at you and say, gee, I want your good housekeeping seal of approval, but if I don't get it, I'm going to ignore you. I will abide with endorsement.
I'm seeking the endorsement, and we're working hard to earn the trust and respect of all the Republicans that participate in that process. We'll decide at a later date if we abide by the endorsement or not as the process unfolds. But I am focused on also being ready to drive forth a successful primary that will lead to a successful general election. And I do believe it's important that we work on getting our message out to the broader electorate. And as everyone knows, that primary has the general election falling very closely on its heels. And I want to make sure that we're using that time and that primary process to work on getting the vote out and playing catch up, which unfortunately we need to do because I think the Republican Party is a little bit behind the times, and we saw that some in this last election. And so we'll make sure that we're putting resources into winning the primary. I'm looking forward to doing it as the endorsed candidate and taking us on to win the general election.
Well, I will abide by the endorsement as well. And can I say that? I say that not just because I believe in our caucus system as Dave does, but I'm one who has gone through that system as an activist for the past 20 years, and I think it's what makes our party work. But also, I really believe that this is by far the best chance for us to win in 2014. We don't have the numbers to win an election as Republicans in this state unless we have every single solitary Republican on board, and then on top of that, get a whole bunch of independents and a handful of Democrats. And I can guarantee you, if we have a nasty primary ballot in August, and people can say whatever they want, but it'll be a nasty primary ballot because that's how it works, we will lose Republicans. Maybe it'll only be 5%. We can't win if we lose 5% of the Republicans. So I'll abide by the endorsement because I believe in it, but also because I think that's the only way we're going to win next year.
In my first election in 1992 as a delegate to the convention, I was a delegate for a candidate who lost. He lost and had to go, after 25 years of experience, a rock rib conservative, had to go and retire. I don't think there's a choice being made here for us. The decision's already been made for me. I'm going to absolutely work as hard as any of these folks up here for the primary, but the decision's been made for us. Each time I've ran for office, six different times I've been endorsed. I've been very proud of the endorsement. I actually put on my literature, I put on my posters, a Republican-endorsed candidate. I will seek the endorsement. The decision's already been made for us. So I will prepare for not only the Republican convention, and I do believe in my heart of hearts that I can be the endorsed candidate, but also can win a primary election.
Republicans seem to labor under an inherent electoral disadvantage, and that is defined by the Democratic Party benefiting from union contributions, which are pulled from dues which are coerced from workers who may or may not support that party and its policies. We also have outside organizations such as the Alliance for a Better Minnesota who are very active in this state. If selected as our candidate for governor, how would you counter these perceived disadvantages and work to elect Republicans up and down the ticket?
Well, I think it's critical that we work together as a party, not only to win the governorship, to win back the House, to win the Senate, and do so in a way that brings forth a common set of principles, which I believe are around jobs, the economy, education, topics that are on everyone's mind in this state. And I think if we get candidates with those sort of principles, we can win. And I'd like to see more citizen legislators. I really applaud folks that have dedicated their career to politics, but I think we need more people coming into this process that come with outside perspectives. And I'll work hard. I already have been working hard. I've written checks to representatives and senators and been out door knocking with folks, and I'll continue to have that attitude as governor. And we'll work to build a coalition of support that will counter what the other side has in a way that really is working together on behalf of all citizens of the state.
I think we counter ABM and the unions and all the nasty stuff that they're gonna do by taking them head on and fighting back and not letting it define us this time, because we tend to roll over for this stuff because we say we're different. And by the way, we are. It doesn't mean we gotta be nasty and mean and stoop to their levels, but we cannot let anything go unanswered. And that is a problem that we've had in the past. So I would intend, in my own sweet Minnesota way, to respond to everything that they throw at me. And by the way, I don't think they've got a lot of great things to throw at me, because the best thing ABM could come up with in their initial video against me was that I endorsed Newt Gingrich for president and he cheated on his wife. That's as good as it gets for them. Maybe it'll get better. But nonetheless, no matter what, and we responded. And I think we have to respond. We can't get distracted by that, but we don't let them define us. And then, on top of that, we gotta raise enough money to fight fire with fire. And that just means, not, doesn't mean just the candidate, but we've gotta make sure we've got national and outside groups helping us so that they're not outspending us 2 or 3 to 1 like they have in the past.
Well,
most of you in here are activists and delegates. Let's talk shop. Who's raised money in the room? Who's raised $3.5 million, not only for our caucus, who's given to our caucus? Out of my own campaign, I raised and gave $34,000 to the House Republican caucus to help win seats. I have done fundraisers for city council members, for state legislators, both House and senators. Not sorry, Dave, we weren't one, but you're not exactly a vulnerable member. But I did fundraisers all across the state of Minnesota. I door knocked in Moorhead at the end of October, when if you've been in the Red River Valley, the wind isn't exactly light in October. We raised over $5 million. I raised money for the party. I raised money for the redistricting fund. I raised money for any Republican that asked me. As Speaker of the House, I was the highest elected official in the state of Minnesota. I thought it was not only incumbent upon me, but it was my job. So whenever asked, I went. Whenever asked for a check, I gave. I got my House colleagues to donate to the Elephant Club when the Elephant Club was actually about this book. We were running on fumes. We gave. I will go anywhere in the state and I will raise money. I will go toe-to-toe with these folks because they will not have one charge unanswered by me as a candidate or ours as a party.
We absolutely have to raise money. It's a fact of life in politics, and we have to be good and we have to be effective at it. But there's a couple of other things we have to do. I'm glad to know that there are a number of efforts underway with various people to try to make certain we can get our people out to vote, because that's a huge thing, is voter turnout. We've got to work on that. But the last thing I want to come to is something that we can control as candidates, and that is we have to win the marketplace of ideas. We have to be out there with the right messenger. Person who can go into Minneapolis and St. Paul and explain why school choice, why a tuition tax credit will help people to give their children the chance for the American dream that they never had. We have to have somebody who can go up to the Iron Range, into the heart of Union territory, and explain how Union leadership is not serving them well, but that if we get the Polymet mine operating so there are jobs up there, that then they will have success up in the Iron Range. So we've got to win the marketplace of ideas, we've got to get our vote out, and yes, of course, we've got to raise money.
And this will be our final question before we go into closing statements. What, if any, reform do you propose for Minnesota's tax code?
This was my biggest disappointment with Mark Dayton, and it's hard to find your biggest disappointment with Mark Dayton, but this was, and I actually wrote a Star Tribune op-ed about this, which they printed. Governor Dayton had the greatest opportunity in a generation to truly reform our tax code, and he completely punted on it. He'd been talking about it since the day he was elected, and then he got a Democratic House and a Democratic Senate. He could have done anything he wanted, and in the end, what did he propose? A whole bunch of tax increases with little or no reform. To me, tax reform is broad. First of all, we shouldn't be using our tax code to influence people's behavior. We should be using our tax code to raise money for those things that are the responsibility of government. And I think that tax reform means looking at everything, making the property tax system more fair and less complicated, because we have one of the worst in the country. We look at income tax rates and corporate tax rates that are competitive with the states that surround us, and we look at our sales tax to make sure that we're matching what states surrounding us do too. So for me, tax reform is about competitiveness and making this one of the best places to start or expand a business in the upper Midwest.
Unfortunately, no matter who of the four of us it is, we're going to have to do a lot of cleanup. There have been so many bad tax ideas that have been passed in this last 6 months that we will have to start with cleanup. The first one I would eliminate is this warehousing tax. Only place in the country that has it. And Reagan and Will don't allow us to say that since they're not here, and neither is Kim. This is the dumbest idea I have ever heard of. We are the only state that has it. We have driven Red Wing Shoes, a Minnesota-based company. A $20 million facility is now going to be sited possibly in either Missouri or Kansas or Nebraska, just because we thought we could have the one in original idea. We are one pinky finger away from being as high in tax state as California and Hawaii. This is wrong. You start with repealing all those, and then you flatten the rates. You bring taxes down for all Minnesotans. Prosperity shouldn't be based on your zip code, your how much money you make or don't make. And then you reform the tax code policy like we did. We actually took the government officials out of it. No offense to anyone here, but it's direct tax relief for those families to the taxpayer, not filtered through a state or county government.
philosophical position is we use the tax code to generate the money necessary to run government in the most efficient way possible. We don't use the tax code to socially engineer. That being said, what specific taxes will I go after? Absolutely the warehousing tax. But in terms of the large permanent taxes that we're all familiar with, statewide business property tax, horrible. Income tax rate, both personal and business, we've got to do away with. We do need to completely get rid of those taxes that give folks disincentive to live, work, and create businesses here in Minnesota. So we simply need to get away from the taxes that are terrible for business. We need to get away from socially engineering with the tax code, and we need to create predictability. And we also need, this is subtle, but it's important. We need to stop bad-mouthing businesses. We need to stop bad-mouthing successful people. This governor has set the tone that not only are we not really trying to welcome successful people here, we really actually don't like you. That's a terrible message.
I've created jobs. I know what it takes to create jobs. In this country in the last decade, 62% of the jobs created were in the 9 states with 0 personal income tax. I like that as a direction. And I think we need a fundamental reset of what we're doing here in government. We have to start by figuring out what is it that we want in terms of results, what is that going to cost. We're going to for sure reduce the total dollars spent by government. And then we're going to figure out the smartest way to get the budget resources we need to meet those needs. And that's going to be fundamental tax reform. We got to stop talking about individual taxes and how we're going to change something that just came to us because someone had some idea decades ago. We have to eliminate a large number of taxes and fees that have been just piled on. We have to have a simple tax code. We have to reduce loopholes and eliminate them. I'll make sure we lower our tax rates, flatten the tax burden, and have us have a pro-business environment in this state.
All right. I think we'll do closing statements in the reverse order that we did the intro, so we'll start with Gert Zellers.
Well, thank you, and thanks everybody for being here today. We really appreciate the opportunity. It's a great place to not only introduce ourselves, but it's a pleasure to serve and to share the stage with these folks. I'll close with the same reason why I started, why I'm running. It's regular will. It's making sure that not only do they have opportunity, both personal, economic, education opportunity, but that Minnesota is back on the track for success. That we're not a state that looks at each and every business owner as somebody we should shake down, either look at from a negative standpoint or drive out of our state, but we need to be Minnesota competitive, and then we need to focus on excellence. We can be the beacon in the upper Midwest for entrepreneurs, for engineering, for Medtronics of the future to come to our state, not to be driven out because we think you maybe made some money and we want to tax you out of our state, but we want you to come here. As governor, that will be my number one job. I will look to make sure that not only are we successful as students, as parents, as business owners, but as a state, we have the ability, we have a polymet mine up north that is on the cusp of being our North Dakota oil field. If not for Governor Dayton, an environmentalist, we would have that mine open. They've been waiting. They need a governor that's going to come in and say, not only are we going to do it right, but as a good friend of mine said, when the land goes quiet, so when we're done, it will be as pristine and beautiful as it was when we first went there. But while we're mining, we're going to make Minnesota prosperous. We're going to spin off the copper, the nickel, the palladium, the titanium. We need that here. But as governor, you can't have us automatic that is off the table. For me, it will be an automatic. It'll be the first thing I do. And then we need to focus on educational excellence. Again, as I said, my wife Kim's a teacher. We literally live, breathe education choice. We have been recruited families. We brought Minnesotans into our home and actually recruited them for our school. We need to share that with Minneapolis. If you don't live each day of your life, how are you going to convince someone that it's good for their children as well? I thank you again for the privilege to be here. It's great to be a Republican in the state of Minnesota. We've got a great future ahead of us. I ask for not only your support, but I ask for your vote for governor.
Well, thank you. And again, thank you all for being here, and thank you for you guys for putting this together. This was really, truly a great event, and I appreciate that. part of our job as a candidate for governor or any other office is to present a vision for Minnesotans, and not just a vision for Republican activists, but a vision for all Minnesotans. So let me tell you what mine is. My vision for the future of Minnesota is of a state where politicians understand that taxpayers work really, really hard for their money, and we treat it as responsibly and carefully as though it was coming out of our own pockets. We're not seeing that right now. My vision is of a state where every child has a chance of a great education. Not some of our kids, not most of our kids, but every single kid in this state has an opportunity to get a great education. It's a state where the least fortunate among us, the most vulnerable among us, are safe and they're secure, and we treat them with dignity. We don't just herd them into government programs because that makes us feel good, but we actually figure out ways to give them access to the same private market that we're part of, so they can walk beside us in this economy rather than at some level below us. It's a vision of a state where the principles of economic freedom and individual liberty and equal opportunity have replaced this obsession in St. Paul with government involvement in absolutely everything. And most importantly, it's a state where, rather than having the big debate over at the Capitol be about which taxes from the tax smorgasbord we're going to pile onto the taxpayer's plate next, but rather how we're going to unleash that entrepreneurial and innovative power of every individual in this state to help grow the economy and make us all more prosperous. That's the reason I'm running for governor. That's the message that I intend to share with Minnesotans. I'm seeking your endorsement. I'll abide by your endorsement, and I'd really appreciate your support. Thank you.
What?
You know, with Jamie and my family's support, I'm taking a sabbatical from business to do what I think is a tour of duty in public service. I feel like I've lived the American dream, and I want that for everyone. And our state is going in the wrong direction today, and it needs a change in leadership. I'm looking to be a transformational leader that comes in, gets the job done, does a full reset on government. It really brings that culture of customer service and that attitude that we all deserve to see out of our leaders in St. Paul to the governor's office and to the rest of the leadership in St. Paul. And when I'm done, I'm going to go on back to doing all the other things that I love to do and look forward to turning this state's leadership over to a next generation of leaders. I hope I have your support. I'd love to get to know all of you. I'm going to be touring the state listening to Minnesotans, and appreciate you having me here tonight. Thank you.
Well, I guess you can see on the guy that always forgets to pick up the bottle of milk on the way home, right? Change anything on out. So, thank you. Thank you so much for a great event tonight. It's been a lot of fun to be here. I appreciate it. Very impressive that there'd be so many of you here 15 months before the election. That's very encouraging from the standpoint of someone who hopes to be a candidate. But I will admit, I doubt that we have any people in here who are the life of the party. I'm just guessing. But it is great to have you here, so thanks very much. You know, every day during the session, when I drive to the Capitol, I drive up and I see the dome in front of me. I haven't been doing that for long because, of course, I was in the private sector until I was 48 years old, but I now have my 3 years, three sessions, that I've been driving to the Capitol. And I look up at that dome, and number one, I feel it's an incredible honor to be there. And I truly am taken by the degree to which I have to try to own up to my responsibility as a public servant. But I also ask myself many times, what really is it that the people want? And my belief is that is not unique to Minnesotans. It's certainly not unique to the people who live in the city where I happen to live. I don't believe it's unique to people in this country. I believe it's a universal human desire to simply have some control over your own life, to do something that matters to you, and at some point to feel that you got a sense of purpose. So to me, the proper function for government is to facilitate that. And I'll come back to what I've talked to you about many times over the years and now here tonight. What that means is elevating the individual and keeping government in its proper place. And if I'm honored to be your next governor, I can assure you the individual will remain the center of my thought process, and I understand that government is there simply to facilitate people being all that they can be, pursuing and achieving their dreams. I would be honored to get your support and your vote. Thank you so much for being here today.
The final word that I'll put in as moderator, first of all, thank you very much for giving me that honor. Thank you for making this job very easy. Each of you as candidates made this job very easy. You folks made this job very easy. And you right there keeping time. I hope that you'll join me in standing convicted that we will elect a Republican governor.
On behalf of SB 31, 35, 36, and 37, we are indeed, what's the matter? Did I forget you? You can come up too. We are indeed honored to have these four gentlemen up here in front of us tonight. So let's give them a big round of applause. By far, we are indeed honored and overjoyed to have all of you here tonight. It's a fantastic turnout, and we really appreciate it. I'm sure these gentlemen will stay here as long as they can in order to talk to you about anything that you'd like to speak with them about. As you can tell, I'm the only politician in the group. So. Anyway, thank you very much. Thank you, gentlemen. So let's retire for some more personal questions and answers.